Okay, so today I will talk a little bit about a framework we have developed at the Otto Group, and the talk is structured as follows. I will introduce a little bit the motivation behind this framework and the history of it. I will talk a little bit about the architecture, not the architecture of the framework, but how to actually use it. Then we will hopefully walk through a little demo of Palladium. So I would like to show an example classification service that can be set up with Palladium. And then if we have enough time left, then I will show how to deploy such a predictive analytics service with Palladium in combination with Docker, Mesos, and Marathon. So that's basically the outline of the talk. So why have we started thinking about such a framework? Basically, it is that during our work in the data science team, we had different situations where we were doing prototypes, and then there had been some re-implementations of these prototypes, and in the end, we had the feeling that it somehow is a waste of time or a little bit a waste of energy to do it in such a way. And there is a great bunch of packages out there which is working reliably and efficient. So the idea was to, if we spend some time once to have some generic framework to deploy some of our machine learning models as services, then we can save time in the future. And the idea emerged during one project we did with Hermes, where we did some parcel delivery time prediction. So the task was to predict at what time the parcel will be delivered. I cannot tell a lot about the data, but it was not such an easy task. And during that project, we started developing some framework with loading, saving and loading models, and loading the data, and did a lot of different things. And then we thought, well, maybe if we do what we are actually doing right now and do it in a little bit more generic way, then this might help a lot of people, and that's what we are hoping. So we came up with implementing Palladium based on the results of this project. So what is Palladium? Actually, it's a framework that helps you to fit models, to distribute models, store metadata for models, to evaluate models, and it's basically based on the interface of scikit-learn. So most things we're doing here is to use existing functionalities of other packages, and so I'd say that the scikit-learn is the package that is has the most influence to our package. So it can be used for model management, as I said before. It's one of the core tasks is to expose a machine learning model as a web service. So what it actually does for you is you can do your machine learning model with a scikit-learn estimator or whatever estimator you feel like using. And then you can use this framework to launch a web service for your predictions, and which is actually helping you to get rid of some of the coding work you don't feel like doing every time. It's very flexible. I hope you will find out in a minute, because we have a configuration file where you can configure most of the things, and via interfaces you can integrate your own code. We have a mechanism for automated updates of models, so if you have a model that is trained every day, then you could set up Palladium in a way that every day it reloads the model that has been generated before. And as I mentioned before, for scalability, it's possible to, well, you can do this with everything, but to create a Docker image, and we have some support for this also in Palladium. So, yeah, well, that's slides for the bosses. Our core framework and a lot of reuse of the code, and then we can plug in different code for models. Okay, what is the one example situation, how to use it? I've divided this slide in two parts, fitting and evaluating models. So we have some train server where we have one Palladium instance running. We have some source for training data, some source for testing data, and we have some place where to persist models, and so we can run a command to fit a model, and it's stored in a place we want it to be stored. And during application time, we have a predict node where Palladium is running, and the model can be drawn from this model persister, and actually expose a web service in order to provide this machine learning model to whatever use case you want to have it. And usually, you have a situation more like that, that it's not only one predict node, but a number of predict nodes. Okay, we also have some mechanisms, you want to put it behind a load balancer usually, and we also have some support, and I will show that in a minute, to integrate easily further functionality like monitoring or logging via decorators or authentication. So this can be rather easily done with the configuration of Palladium. Okay, I mentioned the configuration before, and so I will briefly talk about the structure of the configuration. We have one part where we describe where we can get the data from in order to train a model. So this is a data set loader for training. We have one part where we actually describe what is the model to be trained. So usually we have some estimator here that can be fit. We have a model persister, and this can be a database or it can be a flat file, the place where the generated models are stored at. We have the predict service. That's the place where you describe actually the structure of your web service. So what is the parameters that can be fed into the service, and how's the response format? So this would be defined here. Then you can also use the grid search in one section of the configuration file, and similar to the dataset loader for training data, you can use the same for testing data. Okay, so I brought one example, an example that most likely everyone in this room, or I'd say 95% might know, the iris classification task. So it's a task. It's rather an academic toy example that is widely used, so why not use it here? Where you have some information about sepal lengths and widths and petal lengths and widths of this flower, and you want to classify it into one of these three categories, iris setosa, versicolor, and virginica. I've never seen one in real life, or maybe I have, but I don't know. And we have some training and test data. And what I want to show you now is how to train a model using Palladium, and to make it possible to just send a request as the one shown up here, and to get a response like that. So now I have to switch to my virtual box, and now I need a third hand. Or I can try to, thanks. Okay, so let's take a look at, is it loud enough? Yeah. To the data, you've seen it before, so we have these different values and the classification result we want to have. Then, I will now open the configuration file I mentioned before. So it's different ones here, but is it large enough to see also in the back? or should I increase font size? Okay, thank you. So we have some basic information, metadata information about the service we're running. So you might want to put your versions here. Then we have the section for the loading training data. And here's one example for just using the read CSV. So it's a dataset loader that is just reading CSV files, and where you can say where can I find the file, what are actually the names of the columns if they are not provided, what is the target column in order to train something, and yeah, basically just what the read CSV function provides can be used here. It's the same for the dataset loader test, with the difference that we are using the first 100 rows for training and the 50 rows after for testing. Then this is the model section where you can specify what estimator to use. Here's the decision tree classifier and just with one parameter. And I should mention this factory entries in the configuration. So that's one part of the Palladium where you can plug in something into the framework, so the configuration will be passed and it will be checked for factory entries, and then actually the init function of this class is used, and the arguments below are passed to the init calls. So you can basically plug in what you like. You could even plug in nasty code if you feel like, but that's what's happening. So it helps to have a flexible framework here. Then in the grid search section, you can specify if you want to check what parameters are helpful for this learning task. And the model persistor, maybe we first take a look at the part here below, is the place where models are stored. And this is a database persistor, so it's using the SQL Alchemy in order to store the models in some place. And basically, it's just using the it's pickling the model and storing the model at that place with some additional metadata. And you can have one active model, which is used for predictions. And I will show in a minute how to select these models. Okay, and the predictor, well, you've seen that before, is the place where we define what is the mapping, what's the input to our service, and what are the types that we are expecting here. Okay, I will skip this alive part. And what we can do now is, just go to the shell, check if there's some. There's one environment variable which has to be set. And then you can, we have a number of scripts that can be run, and PLD fit is training a model. So it's yeah. I have to mention that there's one McAfee process using 100% of my CPU, so that's why I plugged in to the power supply. The battery is not sucked out that fast. Okay, so we have fit a model. We can do it once again. So we've seen there was written a model in version 1. Now we have version 2. We have another script where we can list all the models that have been created so far. So we see a train timestamp and a version, but it's up to you if you want to add further metadata. So we have something also included. So it's evaluate, where we can, where you actually the trained model is applied against training data and testing data. And if I list the models once again, then you will see that that for version 3, so third model, we additionally have the score and training and testing data that we have captured. Okay, I mentioned that we can, you see here that that we have the active model 3. We could activate a different model. So if we find out that the second one was better, then we could activate a different one, and hopefully that is activated. Okay, just quick walkthrough other functionalities. We can do a test on the, using the dataset loader for testing, and then the active model is tested against this model. We can perform a grid search, and then the parameter combinations, as it has been specified in the configuration file, are checked against with this model, and then we could decide that we want to change the parameter somehow. Yeah. So there's one thing I haven't shown you, one core functionality actually, that we have trained the model, and now we want to expose it as a web service. So now this is using the Flask web server, the built-in development web server. So in production, you might want to use something else. And then it's exposing the model here at port 50,000 in this case. And now we can check if our predict node is alive. So that's the alive entry point, to giving you some information about the memory usage, the service metadata, Palladium version used, and what model is currently loaded. And then we can run requests against this service, and we, as well, you might have seen from the numbers, that's Iris Virginica. So what else could it be? Okay, so that's the basic functionality. I said that it's possible to to adapt this easily, and I would like to show you two things. So one thing I would like to show is what if we want to change the response of this the Palladium configuration. And there I have have a second configuration file, and in this configuration file I just used a different predict service. So I've changed one line here to use another predict service, and the implementation is as follows. My server. So I have just inherited from predict service, which is part of the Palladium classes, and I just wrote one method, response from prediction, and I added this code that I additionally want to have some prediction ID, because I want to refer later on to this prediction. Maybe I want to store some something in my log files about this. And now I have to go to the shell. I restart with the different configuration file, and now we get our prediction ID in the response. So it's rather easy to come up with your own ideas how to use it, this here. And a second example I wanted to show to you is that I also added some part. So let's assume that you want to lock every predict call. Then we can add a decorator. So actually, I added a rather simple decorator, which is just printing the duration that a function took. So recording the time before and afterwards, and printing this. And this print duration decorator can now be added to our configuration file. So should have it here. via this entry predict decorators, and actually we have implemented a pluggable decorator which where you can provide a list of decorators, and all these decorators are then added to different functions. So for the predict call, for the alive call, you can add something like that for the fit call if you're fitting a model. So there are different places where you can actually add such a pluggable decorator list, and then this is automatically used, so I just have to restart. And then if I do a request, then it should, yeah, it's calling, it's using this decorator here, and you could do something more fancy, send a request to a logging server or something like that. Okay, how much time do we have left? 10 minutes, okay. So then I'd like to just show you or give you the information that we have quite a lot of documentation at read the docs. There's also a tutorial section which is doing basically things I'm doing right now. So if you want to try it on your own later on, then that might be a good point. Okay, what I want to do now is, I said that I also want to put our Palladium service into a Docker container, and therefore we have a command. Unfortunately, I cannot run it right now, or I don't want to run it right now because I don't have set up internet connection and it's trying to pull something, so it's not a good idea. But we have a command, pld dockerize, is it? Pld dockerize. So you can specify where you can find the configuration file and whatever else code you need to run your service. What is the base image? There's a Palladium base image that is used here. And what is the name of your Docker image, the name and version of your Docker image you want to do? I've done this before. So we have one Docker image right here. Actually, we have two. One could be used for fitting models or standalone, and the other one is also doing a fit command inside the Docker file already. So there we have already a model which has been fit. Okay, so now I could start it like that, but I don't feel like. So I want to also have set up, besides Docker, the Mesos and Marathon. And so this Marathon and Mesos is, well, it's a quite nice combination where you can, maybe I should jump back for 1 minute. And walk down here. Is it? So with Mesos, you actually can abstract from your resources, and so it can be used as a cluster framework for the hardware you have available. And Marathon can be used to launch and monitor services. And so I hope that I can do it with one hand, but still do it with, as part of the demo. No, I think it's not that many things I have to do right now. So I let you know if I need you. So what I'm doing right now is there's one command where you can use where you can send a post request with a configuration file, and this configuration file basically maybe I can just cut it. It describes what Docker image to be used, what port mappings we have, how many resources we need, so how many CPUs, and how much memory, how many instances should be started. So this is a configuration that can be used for Marathon. And if we actually send it, just for the effect. So right now there should be nothing running here. This is a web interface of Marathon. And if I send this, then three instances of our nice Palladium Iris service should be launched. So here you see that an application is deploying, and we can click on that. And now we see that, oh, well, I'm sure everything is fine, but that these instances have been started. Well, now we are healthy once again, so whatever that was. So now it's possible to access as this our predict service as we've done before at these ports. So 31847. Well, I'm sure you believe me. Oh, what was it? 817. Now it was 8. Yeah. Okay. And now we can could combine this. And the nice thing is that you have some possibilities to scale the application here. I can say now I feel like having 5 of these instances, and it's automatically launching the other ones. Yeah, here we go. And if I kill one, then it will be restarted once again. So I could be mean and just remove one of these containers. But I think I'm at the end of my time. So, or how much time do I have?
4 minutes.
I still have 4 minutes. Ah, excellent. Then I'll do that. So we could force the removing one of these. Ah, that doesn't work. Yeah, so now only 4 are healthy, 1 is missing, and then it will be relaunched later on. Okay. Yeah, I'm sure you believe me, so we don't need to wait here. Let's see. I've mentioned all this. Yeah, then I'll come to the summary. So Palladium is a framework to expose machine learning models as web services, and we have tried to integrate a number of functionalities that you need in many projects, and you don't feel like re-implementing over and over again, or you don't want to have redundant code in different repositories, but we wanted to put it in one package. And to have one really well-tested code here. And I can say that in our daily work, it helped a lot, because we're exposing many different machine learning models as web services. And this has helped us a lot to have some, well, kind of kind of standardized process how we do this. And we have one core code where we have quite some are quite sure that it's working well, and it's working robust, and it's really fast to set up a web service using this framework. As I've mentioned, we have some possibility to create Docker images. You can also just create a Docker file and edit it if you want to adapt something there. Then we have this our decorator lists in order to flexibly change parts of this predict node. And what I've not mentioned so far is that we also have shown how to integrate other languages. So we have used R, PyTo, and the Julia Bridge in order to also expose these models with Palladium. But to be honest, that was rather, well, not on production setting. That was just showing how it could work, but we haven't spent too much time here. Okay, and it's available at GitHub and PyPy, etc. So we are happy if we find people who are also interested in it and using it. And we're also happy if someone is giving feedback or even doing something, extending or finding bugs, whatever. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very, very, very much, Andreas, for this great talk. Does anybody have any questions? Yes, we do. Okay, so let's start with the back before I forget you. And don't remember to repeat the question. Thank you very much.
Well, actually, the question was if this framework was used for parcel delivery time prediction, and I think, unfortunately, I cannot talk about this. On the one hand, I'm sorry, and on the other hand, Palladium was not existing that time, so it was just that this project was kind of the birth of the project idea. So one colleague, I'm not sure if he's here, Timo Ducho, who's also around at the PyData, who was head of data science at that time, he said, well, we should use this or take this and put it on a more generic level because it will help us in different situations. Was there some order? I don't.
So, first of all, yeah, it's awesome work, and I'm definitely going to use this. First question is: does the server also accept like JSON, for example? Can you send it multiple like rows with features and get multiple predictions?
Mm-hmm. The question was if it's possible to send multiple rows, and you can also send a POST request with JSON formatted code. And what I've another thing I haven't shown is that we also have some mode, we call it a PLD stream, where it's just listening at standard in and sending the results to standard out. We have used this in combination with Hive queries and did quite a lot of predictions on our cluster. And there you can also send a list of requests in JSON format, and then you get the responses back. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But analogous, we are trying to achieve basically a similar thing. And our main, let's say, main problem is to send the data that should be the basis of the prediction. You know, like you send like the leaf, the sizes of iris, which is pretty straightforward. But in normal case, I mean, I think we have other groups, if you try to predict what the customer will buy, if you send them a catalog or whatever,
mm-hmm. So the question is how to deal with larger data or so. Well, in general, our approach is rather to do this in some pre-processing steps to have this on the Hadoop side have some more concise representations of things we need. You could also do it, but then you might get problems with memory or whatever. So if you really do everything inside Palladium, so it's not, you can do a pipeline and you can do some pre-processing things from scikit-learn, but it depends on the actual application, if it's still possible to put everything inside, or if there's some other steps before. Unfortunately not. So the question was if it's possible to also do a training on distributed setting, but this is not possible here.
Next question?
I should also.
Yes.
So just a quick comment on the time complexity when you interface it with scikit-learn. Like, it's very scikit-learn friendly. Do you have an estimate of, suppose when you want to run a group search for an FDM, how long will Palladium take more than
Oh, the question is the overhead for a grid search, but we haven't checked that. What we have checked, and I skipped that slide. I skipped many slides actually, where we tested the service overhead of Palladium. So, but just the predict calls, and what we found out that in this setting that it's really very, very small overhead. So it's basically this is one iris. Service, nothing special happening in the model, but this is really the whole web service request. So in the end, we have 1.2 milliseconds per request using this framework. So it's quite performant, good performing here. Yeah. The question is what to do in this Docker setting if we have different predict nodes and you want to share a model, and different train nodes. Yeah, okay, then I got you. So the question is how to share one trained model in different predict nodes. And you can also do this, so it's you could do that when you start your container, that where you need you need to have access to the model persister. So if you have for instance a database or some place where you can load the model, then during startup of the predict node, it would take the model from that position. So if in your network setting you have some place, some database or whatever, where the model is stored, where every predict node has access to, then it would take exactly that same model. And with this update mechanism, you could set it up that every night at 4 a.m. it should reload the model, and if there's a newly trained model in this model persister, then it would retrieve it and use the other model for predicting.